Well, I certainly would like to thank Professor Kennedy for that absolutely fascinating account of a very, very dramatic period in our history. The way that he brought the local and the national into the international and the global was indeed very, very exciting, and thank you for that. And I also was very impressed at the depth of his research. I was watching the sources there. Very, very good research indeed. Certainly, the next time I visit Malin Head, I'll look at it in a very different context, and you know, they really should have a proper centre there, and hope it speeds up a little bit. It makes a very good case for it. You've made a case for it here today. So we'll take a few questions. Okay. Any questions, please? Yes, Brendan.
with the reports from, as you say, Madam Haig, which at the time Madam Haig hadn't been taken over by the Irish government, and neither I think had met the station of Maxar Bay. The National Service was established in Mines in 1937. It's interesting to that corroborates what you were saying about the relevance of the reports. And it's interesting to reflect also in the context of your magnificent lecture that when I was working in 1960, very, very frequently, it's hard to imagine now, flights from America everything would have to be cleared to let them in, because they might arrive off the coast of Ireland with a spoonful of juice left in the tank. You know, does that tie on the kind of relevance? The other thing that is interesting, I think, is that De Valera, who of course was a teacher at the time, owed his life to the fact that he was an American citizen, and when he was due to be executed during the 1916-22 period, became an American citizenship, kept alive a very close relationship with the country of America at his birth. And I think the ambivalence of Irish neutrality during the war owes its, on one side, De Valera instinctively would have been very benign towards American forces and American war needs, whereas on the other side, he had an abiding and mutual hatred of Mr. Churchill, who, after the negotiations in 1920, described negotiating with Churchill as like trying to spoon to move mercury with a fork. I think that was the description. So that at the outbreak of the war, certainly in Met Service kind of lower, there would have been a very distinct difference between the Dublin attitude towards Washington and their attitude towards London, which mellowed during the period. The attitude towards America probably would have been even more benign had we had a less idiosyncratic representative from America than Edward Grey.
Yes, I think I do. I think you're quite correct there. Grey was a very idiosyncratic individual, and his departure in 1947 was something that some officials in external affairs certainly mopped their brows and breathed a sigh of relief when his the tender brought him to the liner off Cove, and off he went. I mean, he was given a great seeing off, but he was a very difficult individual to deal with, and he had very, very set views on how relations should be carried out indeed. And De Valera did always, I think, look to the American example of neutrality. And he based a great deal of his policy on it. And he said, and because of the way events turned out, we tend to forget this, he said, we are neutral until we are invaded. It doesn't matter who invades us. And I think he was looking at the American example there as well. His chief of staff, General McKenna, who was a dairyman, always felt that the ultimate enemy, if I can put it that way, would be Germany. And he was the man who said, who are we neutral against? But he wanted to have his... Yeah, it's a good one. He wanted to base all his forces down on the south coast, but political considerations meant that there had to be a division, and the Irish Army was only 2.5 divisions in size during the war. There had to be a division based up along the line of the Boyne that could go north. But De Valera is always influenced by what happens in America, and even for the basis of Ireland's neutrality policy, he's looking at United States policies towards Cuba in the early decades of the 20th century. So it is a massive influence on him, you're absolutely right.
Sisters all, as we look to see what stories are told and what stories are still to be told about Malin Head, about Leinfort, about Dunree, about the Nation Peninsula, about the Glengad and the Malin Head era, and further out in Nation Head. I think, Mr. Reilly, if I was going back to my history in college in Cardona, I'd have to revise what I was told, because I believe in Steve Jack, convinced we were never in the middle of the road, we were never, what's your term?
Neutral.
And I heard the words construe, interpret, and imagine a lot today from yourself. And I wonder, is there a language there that politicians, local and national, strive for, but that language is only in the hold of the diplomatic corps? And is that even right today when there's an impasse up the road? We're striving again for America, and maybe that language of the diplomatic corps to help us out.
Well, I think you're right. It's a language that I think has become kind of infused into me over the years working on diplomatic history. So even when I'm dealing with problems at home or whatever, we might have full and frank discussions or we might strive to do something, and it is something that sinks in. I'm reminded of another phrase, since we're talking about that. The individual who's responsible for so much of this policy and this constructive ambiguity, there's another one in language, is Michael Rinn, who was the legal advisor in the Department of External Affairs for this period. He ended up as ambassador to Spain in the 1950s. And Rinn had studied law across Europe in the early 1900s. He'd studied at the Sorbonne, he'd studied in Frankfurt and Munich, and he was on De Valera's staff in the run-up to the signing of the treaty. And he had a lovely phrase, and it's in a policy document from 1939. He talks about the trackless desert of modern neutrality law. And I think even for those of us like me who don't have a legal background, that explains what Ireland is trying to do, what any neutral tries to do. I mean, Switzerland was the same. I was at the Military Museum in Stockholm some months ago, and there's a panel exhibition on Swedish neutrality. And you simply take out the words Sweden and Germany and put in Ireland, the United Kingdom, it's the same story. And the Swedes have the same debate about the nature of their neutrality as we do about the nature of ours. And it's, I don't know, something of maybe the guilt of neutrals, or the neutrals realize maybe we shouldn't have done this, or maybe we should have thought differently. And you saw it recently in the debate over the pardons to deserters in the Irish Defence Forces, but whom nobody actually knows where they deserted to. It was a media fiction on this, that all 600 and whatever of them went to fight with the Allies. There's no evidence of that at all. Many of them did, but nobody actually knew where they went. So the language is very important. The language is something to study, and it's the language that is the basis of, and our army, as many of you know, was very small during the war and could only fight roughly for 24 hours before it was going to be Britain came in. The plans were there for the trucks to roll over the border down from Belfast and bases in South Armagh. And it was in many ways our diplomatic service who were our front line of defence through the use of that language. To, I don't know if pen is mightier than the sword or something to put in here, but it's through that language and through the relationship that they could have, be it with Churchill, with Goering, because we had a diplomat, a chargé in Berlin during the war. To bring my answer to an end, really, the basis of local comes in here again. The man who was the Irish ambassador in London during the war, John Delante, was a former Treasury official. He was of Irish background, Irish immigrants in Manchester. He'd worked his way up through the British Civil Service. He was, in fact, Churchill's election agent in 1909. Now, he transferred over to the Irish diplomatic service, but he had that kind of connection with Churchill, and he would go in and see Churchill if there ever was a problem, and he'd sort it out. So it is the local side comes in there again, the personal side, the language. He was also the only member of the diplomatic corps in London who could pick up the phone to Buckingham Palace and get the king. He had that sort of level of connection. He's a fantastic diplomat, and I'll end on this point. Some years ago, the embassy in London found hidden away behind a partition a whole cache of his private papers that he'd put there at some time. And it was only when the embassy was being renovated they discovered this file, and my colleague and I got a call to go across to London and look at them. And we were like, I don't know, kids in a candy shop, really. I mean, you could not imagine that. We sent a third secretary down to the basement, and he brought more up, and he said, I don't know what's in these files, but I can see from the look on your face that you were having the time of your lives. And that was Delante's negotiations with Churchill. So the language is really important.
So we may have to rewrite the textbooks, or maybe, well, I'd say the iPads nowadays.
What I'd say is all good historians are revisionists, but with a small r. All history is. And the work I do is being reinterpreted by my graduate students, and the book you referred to on cross-border relations. I was delighted when a couple of years ago one of my doctoral students came in and he said, chapter 5 in your book, you're wrong. Here's the evidence. And I thought, it's brilliant. It's past the parcel. You know, what I got from Ronan Fanning, who was my doctoral supervisor, who would have been here today, I'm passing on to other students, and they in turn will rewrite, reinterpret, re-understand aspects of history we're only just getting to grips with now.
Okay, any more questions? Yes, Shams.
First of all, congratulations on your lecture. I just want to know what the range of vision for these coast guards. I mean, if a U-boat surfaced, say, 12 miles out, number one, would it be seen? Mm-hmm. And number two, would the British forces be told about it?
I can answer the second part first, and I'll come back to that. British forces would be told. Particularly when it came to... Well, they'd be told, particularly when it came to aircraft, they'd be told, but everybody would be told. Because the Irish policy was we'd broadcast it on a certain radio frequency, so anyone could pick it up. A neutral can do that, they can broadcast it to the world. But only British sets would be able to pick it up because of the endurance of the signal. So this is back to this kind of constructive. You know, it's. And as to what the posts can see, that depends on their elevation. And so the posts that I think are of the greatest significance are those that are highest up with the best panorama. Malinhead is excellent for that. Those of you who know it will realize the perspective it has. Howth Head in Dublin is superb because it can see the whole way across the Irish Sea if you have a good pair of binoculars. Regularly in the reports you see snow on the mountains of Wales this morning. So those posts are useful. Moytigue Head at the end of Achill Island, brilliant. Eris Head. And it was Eris Head that got me first interested in this. When I was up there one day and talking to a friend of mine, a diver up there, about it. And he said, oh, the records of these posts are back in military archives in Dublin. And I went back and I got one of the 1944 logbooks, and I saw flying fortress after flying fortress. And I didn't realize these aircraft came across our airspace. It had never occurred to me. Because my school history was a neutral Ireland is here. That's today's lesson, and then sometime later down the road we'll do World War II, but the two don't intertwine. So the elevation is the critical thing. And the other thing, of course, that's most important is training of the men. And posts where the corporal is a man who might have some background in seafaring, then he will instruct his men. And it's that basic idea of military training that you help your men out, you train your men, and you all work together as one. Carnsore Point down in Wexford. Ivor Murphy, who ran that post, has his men taking bearings, he has them triangulating, doing all sorts of things that I haven't seen in any other posts. So I mean, that's what it's really down to. At the beginning of the war, these men are amateurs. The reports will say, there was a big ship, it had a gun on the front. It's at sea. But by the end of the war, and by training, they're able to say, by looking at the coordinates to local landmarks, you'll know if you're at sea, it's roughly so far, you know, the horizon is so far. The reports get much more technical and much better written. So you can use them. That example I gave of the sighting of the aircraft that sighted Bismarck, that really showed it to me that these reports are of value if the men are well trained, if the post is high up, and if they're in a strategic area. There are some posts where nothing happens during the war, where it's a very easy war that you some of them, I think, Runa in Galway. Men just sit there and... But the size of Malin Head, I think I was talking to somebody about it earlier, was it 30,000 entries in the logbook? Was that the you know, a lot happens here during the war, and that's to put it in very, very simple terms. So I hope that answers the question. Also about the British. The British military regularly visited the posts in civvies, as did American military attachés. There was a British military tour of the south coast of Ireland, I think in 1943, where the Irish Defence Forces, McKenna, Brian, Liam Archer, the Deputy Chief of Staff, bring around a high-level British delegation. And I think part of the view of that is that it's best to know what they're doing, because a British military attaché was prone to go off on weekends and travel around the country, and the guards would pick him up and say, look, you're not meant to be here, would you ever go back to Dublin? And in the end, the arrangement was between the British representative's office and Ivy House was, just tell us where you're going, because we don't want this trouble of having to pick you up yet again, and you're in a place that you're not supposed to be. So that's the level of what's happening. I hope that answers the question.
Thanks. Congratulations, Michael. Just fascinating. As I was talking earlier about the lookout post of Malin Head and the 30,000 plus entries, it's something I didn't realise that the corporal in the news was important, that role was, he was talking about his house was actually nearest to the tower. It's a little cottage. You're standing up in the tower looking back. It's called Cornelius's Cottage, because that was the name of it. I don't know what that would be from the many memories that it's described. But my question is about the other station on the radio station that we've got, the emergency station, and what did have in the ships at sea, including more radio communication, but also wireless or weather information. And as you know, there were concerns about the neutrality of the radio station on it. So the government, and the question is why, or who pushed them into, they wanted censors to actually go up and sit there and listen to every conversation that was had between the radio officer and the ships at sea. And we understood that was something that we asked the German relations to do. But in light of what you've been talking about there and all the other diplomatic maneuvers, maybe it was just a setup, maybe it was something that is made to look like a version of travel. Because really, as far as the locals were concerned, there was nothing. These guys, the locals would come up from memory, three individuals.
Thank you very much. I think there were sensors appointed at other stations. I wonder also if it links in with the need simply to monitor everything that's going on, and a sensor is a convenient name to call these people by. Another thing that links in with what you were saying is that there were radio sets at Fort Linnan and Dunree that were monitoring Allied communications through the war, and even if they were coded, it was the frequency of the reports that was interesting to intelligence, because then, okay, the deciphering capabilities of G2 were limited to one man who was also the director of the National Library, who was Richard Hayes, who was very good at breaking, managed to just about break the German legation cipher during the war and was working on others. He was our one-man Bletchley Park over here. But the need to monitor all that traffic is paramount to what Dan Bryan is doing. He wants to be able to have an insight into every communication, be it postal censorship, of which there was a huge amount during the war, radio censorship, any form of them. Partially, it goes back to the point about the language, so we can say we're doing it. And one of the great fears of the Department of External Affairs during the war was, if we don't do it, someone else is going to do it for us. And that means Brits are going to come in, and they're going to take over whatever apparatus that we don't have. And the parallel here, and I'm developing this out, something I'm looking at the moment, is the other country, or a country very close to us that Britain invaded, another Atlantic country that Britain simply steamrolled into, was Iceland. And that joke that went in recent years, the difference between Ireland and Iceland, you know, one letter in 6 months and whatever. But during the Second World War, Iceland was undefended. It was seen as being strategically significant. And a force of British Marines took off from, I think, Greenock in Scotland, or went off by sea, landed in, I'm not sure where, Reykjavik, wherever they landed, went up the pier, and there was no ability to stop them. Now, in Ireland, you have a lightly equipped army with no major equipment of 45,000. That does the job of, it's enough to deter. And I think maybe the censorship is the same aspect. You've got somebody doing it. Therefore, we can say we're doing it. And it comes back to the language issue of constructive ambiguity, of saying, well, we are doing this now. And I think that links in there. It's a very dangerous tightrope that Joe Walsh is walking during the Second World War. And his, if you look at his health during the war, is up and down. He dies quite young in 1956. He's absolutely shattered by that wartime experience. So that's a very broad answer to your question. I think it's to be seen to be doing it, even if nothing is happening. And also, as I think made the point in the previous question, made the point that many of these facilities still have British ownership in some way, or there's British government involvement. So it's useful for us to have somebody up there who's looking around. I'll finish on this point, but what's happening at Foynes and at Shannon is very interesting at this case as well, in that you've got Irish military intelligence down there, you've got MI6 down there, and you've got the OSS, the forerunners to the CIA down there, and they're all doing this kind of diplomatic dance around the airport, each looking at the other, kind of, you know, spy versus spy kind of thing. And so it's part of that peculiar life that takes place in wartime Ireland. I think the sensors fit into that, and they're a local example of something much, much broader. So thank you for bringing that up. That wouldn't surprise me at all. They sound kind of farcical now when you look at them, but there is a very scary series of files in the National Archives, which are what happens when the Germans invade. And it's down, I don't know if any of you read Peter Hennessy's book, The Secret State, which is about Britain in World War III, where the last cabinet meeting is to be held, where the Queen is to be brought. These are the Irish equivalents to it. It's how do we get De Valera out of Dublin? How do we send the message for help abroad? Different messages for help, depending on who invades. And all those documents were kept, and they're still there in pristine condition, thankfully never needed, for the day when the unthinkable happened. And so that hammer is part of that emergency kit that the Irish state had at its side during the war.
Just to make the point that the relationship between Churchill and De Valera, it would be partly explained, would it not, by the fact that the British handed over the forts in 1938, just a year before the war broke out. And Lough Swilly, for example, 100 years ago, had the Grand Fleet come in to take shelter there from Scapfloth. And the memory of local people watching that fleet as it left on its, as it left the Swilly. And the Dunreary, and you say Lenin, were British forces, were up until 1938. So Churchill realized it was a bad mistake that he handed over the force, and they were also going to hand it back.
Well, yes, and Churchill had been responsible for the negotiations in 1921, whereby Britain kept those three ports, defended anchorages, and he was very taken aback by Chamberlain handing them back in 1938. But if you see it from Chamberlain's perspective, it's appeasement, it's a successful act of appeasement. And what Churchill is, or what Chamberlain is trying to do in its age-old British policy towards Ireland, is to try and keep his western flank on side. So he knows that by giving back the ports, which were in really poor condition by 1938, He's actually saving the British taxpayer money. He's getting Ireland on side, and it's appeasement working successfully. You know, we tend to think of appeasement in terms of Munich and Czechoslovakia, but here it's being used in another context. But Churchill could never see it in that way. He could never forgive Chamberlain for what he did, and he could never forgive De Valera for not handing them over. And a sign of it is that the chief of the Imperial General Staff had equipment, military equipment that the Irish Defence Forces needed, stockpiled in the north, that was to be sent across the border. And he and his senior officer said, this is rusting in Northern Ireland. Would you ever just send it south because they need it? And Churchill, no. I think send them a few trifles was all he said, trinkets. And his phrase about Ireland, and it leads into your question and your point, was they are at war with skulking. They're skulking their responsibility. And he could never forgive De Valera at all. He could never see De Valera's point of view that he felt there would be a civil war in Ireland if Ireland went in on the side of the Allies. And I think the two of them never would see eye to eye. They did meet, I think in 1954 they finally met and shook hands, but Churchill was in very poor health. De Valera was as good as blind, so it was a strange meeting from that point of view. There's a picture of them shaking hands, looking kind of in other, past each other in the front porch of 10 Downing Street.
Okay, just one there, one more.
Oh yeah, yeah. Well, gosh, that could be a lecture in itself, but very, very, very briefly, in early 1941, the Royal Air Force set up a base on Lough Erne, flying boat base, and there were two ways to get to the Atlantic. You flew north and round Malinhead, or you flew across a very small portion of Irish territory between Lough Erne and Ballyshannon and Bundoran and Donegal Bay. And the negotiations, well, the British made this point to the Irish authorities, that's fine. We will allow you to fly across that narrow corridor, but you can't stray outside it. And if you do stray outside it, we will shoot at you, which did occur. The ground defences at Finner, I think there's at least two British aircraft were shot down by them. Now, there's kind of, back to your question, parity of esteem here as well. There were at least two German aircraft shot down off the south coast. So but that's what you do as a neutral, back to Michael Rinn there. You have to defend your territory. So the air corridor was set up in early 1941 as a result of a secret agreement between John Delante, who I mentioned earlier, our ambassador in London, and Churchill. And there's no documentation on the Irish side of any great value that I've ever found on it. The main memoranda are on the British side. But its value, I think, is shown in that point about the Bismarck that I made. And its importance is seen when you look at the lookout post logbooks for St. John's Point down there. The minute the corridor comes into operation, flights across zoom up, and they're extremely important. But it's kept very quiet for the duration of the war. But it's not forgotten about in the British official histories. It's there when you read diplomatic reports after the war, between people like Ernie Bevin discussing with, say, Sean McBride, who was foreign minister in the inter-party government. There's a British memory of the help that was given by Ireland during the war. But on a wider scale, it gets played down because of the impact of Churchill's war memoirs that talk about ERA being, back to the gentleman here, at war but skulking and not living up to its responsibility as an international entity, as a sovereign state. So and that's where the air corridor comes from, and it functions for the duration of the war, and it is extremely important in the world.
In relation to Germany, did they know anything about it, or how did the Irish government, relation to Germany?
Again, coming back to language, the German minister in Dublin during the war, Edward Hempel, played a very cautious game in that he made sure that the reports that he sent back to Berlin made the point that De Valera does not want to come into the war, therefore do not provoke him. And the German air superiority over Ireland lasts for 1940 and into 1941. By the time the United States have entered the war, the Allies have air superiority over Ireland. As those of you who know about the Irish military will know, we still cannot defend our own airspace. We rely covertly on NATO to do that. We can provide limited ground air support for troops. And German aircraft, by and large, are not flying over Ireland after 1940, late 1941. Once the war moves east towards, you know, on the Eastern Front and Hitler invades Russia, the amount of German military activity off the Irish coast goes down. Prior to that, it was mainly off the south coast, flights going out to spotting convoys. The Germans aren't given information on the air signs, aren't given information on lookout posts from what I've seen. And I've no reason to assume that there's anything hidden there that would suggest that they were.
Okay, thank you. That concludes the seminar for this morning. And all that remains for me is to, first of all, thank you for coming, thank you for your questions, thank you for those answers, and thank you indeed for that excellent lecture, which we really enjoyed very, very much.